Hi, this is Walter Beasley for WalterBeasleyLessons.com. And right now I'm going to talk about an exercise that I use very frequently to keep my upper register in check as it relates to the pitch. I use my right hand. This is discussed ad nauseum on WalterBeasleyLessons.com. I have other exercises and other lectures dealing with it. But what we do is we use the right hand, because the right hand is usually down at the bottom of the horn. We bring the right hand up, we play a middle G, and we simply push the octave key with the right hand while we're playing the middle G, and we don't lip up or anything. We just want to hear the sound of that upper G by pushing the octave key at any time. So we push it and don't give ourselves an opportunity to pinch or think about how it's going to sound. I'll demonstrate. And if it doesn't come out, we don't worry, because we're just interested in the pitch and not going sharp or not pinching. So it sounds like this. We just use the belly or use the core or use the diaphragm to push the air out without pinching anything. Listen. And we don't worry about when the sound presents itself. We just blow until it does. Now I know that those two G's are pretty much identical. Do them again. Use the right hand on the octave key so that it's uncomfortable for my mind to process. That means I'm not going to be intense about, I'm not going to, if I use my right hand, that's an edit. If I use my right hand, when I use my right hand to press this octave key, it's so different that it doesn't allow my brain time to pinch or to get stressed out. It just happens. And then for that one instant, I hear that note sounding at where it's supposed to be, and I don't make any changes here. It is again. We can use somewhere over the rainbow. Right in pitch. See, there's no going up, no going down. I'm just blowing until the note presents itself, and by using my right hand, it's uncomfortable, so I don't pinch. They're not uncomfortable, but it's a little bit different, so I'm not used to that feeling. So I'm just letting the air and the note take care of itself. Here it is again. Here's A. So I'm memorizing the way the note sounds when I'm hitting the octave key with that right hand. So if you do this before you warm up and you start memorizing the way the octave feels above that middle G, that middle A, that middle B flat, that middle B, and you can commit that sound, commit that note or that center to memory, then when you're on stage or when you're playing, playing various events or whatever, you can remember that you don't have to pinch, and you can remember that you do have a solid center when it comes to being able to play octaves or being able to play in the upper register, and you don't have to push and you don't have to be anxious, and that's the key. Now I'll demonstrate the process using a song that I recorded off my album called I'm Back, called Living for Today. I don't want to make music. I just want to listen to my intonation and create a space or create a center above, an octave above the G, A, B, C sharp or whatever, and see how I do. Here's how it sounds. Watch it. So I get the bottom note. But it's the same note as the octave below. Just looking for the intonation. So I have my placement, I have my center, because I'm using the same embouchure as I play an octave below. The same embouchure I'm playing with the octave below, and just hitting the octave key, because my mind, or I have internalized and I memorized the way the note should be played an octave higher. How you doing? This is Walter Beasley again. This is round two. I just figured that I would give you a demonstration for those of you who are the young musicians or musicians who might not know what I was talking about exactly. One of the best finishers in R&B history, R&B saxophone history, is Grover Washington Jr. And I want to give you an example of how I learned to play, how a lot of us learned to play. First of all, there's this new age way of thinking about transcription, which is not quite right in my opinion. They're teaching you to learn shapes, the sounds of things, the shapes of the phrases and that kind of stuff. It sounds good, it sounds intellectual, it sounds pretty, but it's bullshit. You learn the solo. I'm not talking about read a transcription from a book. I'm talking about sitting down for as long as necessary to learn that solo. You learn it. That's how you learn how to finish, because there's a conversation that's taking place between the saxophonist and the rhythm section, all right? One more before I go into the studio for another hour or two and then go to bed. I'm in a teaching mode and I don't know why, but I really feel, I don't know, something came over me really quick. It's like, ugh. Ronnie Laws, just a great finisher. One of the best solos in R&B history, saxophone playing, is Friends and Strangers. It is a solo that is melodic, a solo that is understated, but it is as perfect as the solo I just played for you by Grover Washington Jr., because he finishes his phrases so beautifully that he just, it just boggles the mind. And he plays very few notes. So we're going to listen to the solo on Friends and Strangers by Ronnie Laws. I wish I could edit, but I can't. It's true. Watch this. Watch how he sneaks in. Playing with the rhythm section. So finish. Bass. Finish. Twice. Finish. Watch this. Boom. Now the solo's over. Now you might say, well, Walter, this is... No, you don't have to make incredible statements loudly to finish a phrase well. You can listen to Barack Obama speak. He doesn't yell or scream. He just moves you with what he says and how he says it. That's the power of this. So for the young folks, remember, you know, you don't have to scream and holler and play all kinds or sing all kinds of gymnastics and do all kinds of runs to be effective. You simply have to study those who are masters of expression who came before you and incorporate that into your expression. That's all.